Hey everyone, and welcome to this week's Edgecast. Today I'm here with Adam again. You might recognise him, he was on a couple of months ago, I think, went back on.
Yeah, I didn't plan on being on today's podcast, but James Dean from ESL got caught up in Greenwich, so calling you out, James Dean.
We'll get him back on very soon, But there's a good reason to have you on today, and the reason is, probably clear by what's behind us, 1 year.
Happy birthday.
Edge Esports, now Edge, 1 year.
That's happy right. Birthday, yeah, I think thanks, for, first of all, and thank you for being part of the team. And thanks for everyone who's tuned into Mike's podcasts and read his blogs and followed us on our humble journey thus far. I guess, you kind of dropped the bomb there. The news is we are no longer going to be trading as Edge Esports, but we will be known as just Edge. And we have some exciting announcements to that effect.
Yeah, coming very soon. Yeah.
What should we talk about today, man?
Well, let's talk about the last year, really. So first of all, because we are part of the games industry and esports industry, what was your game of the year, the last year?
Game of 2018.
Yeah, I suppose you can count from birthday, from birth date last year until here. So within the last year, I suppose.
I suppose I'm going to be quite vanilla and say Fortnite.
I suppose
October 2017 or November 2017. I got really into it. I played it a lot last year, but I think I was one of the early adopters who said I prefer this to PUBG.
Right.
I think it's the cleanest game I've seen in a long time. The iterative release has been fantastic, like bringing in assets all the time.
Yeah.
Really bringing that battle royale genre to the fore. And then I suppose my sort of honorable mention would be Apex Legends, which I've now stopped playing Fortnite. I play Apex. I love the Overwatch plus Fortnite sort of, more Overwatch plus Call of Duty Blackout, character abilities. And I think that there's, some interesting stuff you could do with that. We've seen a lot of esports, MOBA titles be successful when there's ultimate abilities, same with Overwatch ultimate abilities.
Yeah.
And I suppose Apex, none of the ultimate abilities are particularly strong.
Okay.
Have you played it?
I've not had the chance yet, no. I've seen people playing it though, I've watched it. If we go back to my games of the year, I actually go more towards the non-esports games because when my competitive side comes out...
Mike sucks at video games.
That's basically what it means. so I've really been enjoying a lot of the single player ones because I have been on the other end of the spectrum. There have been a lot of good story games coming out and remakes, reboots.
Such as?
Well, like God of War, for example. I really enjoyed that. So the Spider-Man one was surprisingly good as well.
I heard that, actually.
Yeah.
Did you play Subnautica?
I did not know.
That's a really good sort of survival one-player game. Right. Quite beautiful. That would have been sort of a hipster game. I suppose I also tried that game. What was that called? Yeah, my favorite indie game was a game called Toast.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's from just last year, but you are...
It's where the slice of bread.
You're a slice of bread.
Toast. Yeah, I've seen that one.
You have to get into a toaster. It's quite difficult, actually. Yeah. And then, I love the new Wii. Or the new Wii. This Nintendo Switch.
The Switch is great.
The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild game is...
I only got to play it for a little bit. My brother bought it back for Christmas.
It's insane.
And he was like, play the opening hour or two, and I almost made him leave the Switch.
Yeah.
At our place because I was like, I want to finish this.
I know.
Because we talked before about like retro games and stuff like that, and Zelda for me, especially Ocarina of Time. The first time you get out into Hyrule Field, you just, fell in love with the IP there.
That is the best Zelda game, Ocarina of Time.
It still is, isn't it?
Majora's Mask is some people. It's kind of like, do you like Return of the Jedi or Empire Strikes Back? Right answer is Empire Strikes Back.
Of course. That's not a really good comparison, actually.
Some people
do like Jedi, I think.
We're not talking about Edge, though. We're just talking about video games.
We are talking about video games. So yeah, let's move on. Let's get back to Edge. So for the last year, what has been your highlight, both in terms of Edge as a company, but also in the esports industry? What's been a real highlight for you?
Well... okay, so let's talk about the esports industry at large first. I think one of the highlights it's quite a vanilla again answer, but the growth of the industry as a whole.
Right.
has been mind-boggling. You know, non-endemic brands getting involved.
Yeah.
You know, people who might traditionally not be construed as a non-endemic brand becoming endemic to the industry. So, you know, due to how long they've been there and the prevalence that they, the prevalent position they occupy in gamer culture. Brands like Monster and Red Bull, you know, energy drinks don't necessarily power esports, but to an extent they do in this space. But really cool to see Jack and Jones, Audi, you know, we've partnered with people at the esports bar, and just to see brands like HSBC and Shell who are attending the event and interested in it and say, well, what is this? We need to engage with that.
Mm-hmm.
That's really exciting. And you know, and I suppose that sort of the other thing that has been quite heartwarming from our perspective at Edge is to see, you know, the conference events, people like ESI, Esports Insider, they started hosting esports forums at Fanatics Bunker, I guess it was 12 months ago, 18 months ago. And, you know, Ollie and Sam and their team who do great work, I remember them carrying boxes of beer and, you know, having 40 people at the event, 30, 40 people. Now they're going to casinos, they're going to New York, they're going to Etihad Stadium, and the attendance is phenomenal. And you know, kudos to you guys, you're doing a really good job. So they are one of a number of esports companies that has grown organically, steadily. You know, Maverick Media have gotten a little bit into esports. The esports company who we've also partnered with,
they're doing very well.
E-Premier
Bundesliga and all that as well.
That's really expanding. Seeing like Kairos Media grow, seeing Evolved Talent take the you know, esports agency to the next level. Gosh, ESL selling out ESL One Birmingham and being the fastest ever esports event to sell out of that scale. Yeah. One of the biggest esports events.
I'm sure we'll talk more about that with James when he gets in.
Yeah, little shout out to our buddies at ESL who we share an office with. That's lovely that, you know, people get into the industry because they love video games, they love competitive gaming. And that passion is great, but it ultimately doesn't drive revenue. So if you can marry that passion and energy and deep industry knowledge of esports and video games with, you know, some brands and sponsors and broadcast who are interested in injecting some capital into the ecosystem, and we can all grow together, that's really great.
It's definitely on that path, isn't it? You can see it. It's amazing.
I'm going to talk about Digital Schoolhouse, which is here.
I was going to mention that as well.
Yeah.
Talking about highlights of the year, actually. That was a good one.
So you said highlights of the year for esports in general. The very last one I'd like to shout out is Face It, who did CSGO Major.
Yes.
At Wembley Arena, which we attended, and that was mind-blowing how well they produced the event. And then just looking around the stadium and seeing, you know, 10,000 bums in seats.
Yeah.
That's crazy. And I think that it might have been that same weekend they had a Gears of War tournament and a Rocket League tournament. And I went to the Rocket League as well. And there was I don't remember if it was specifically that one, but there was one weekend in London where there were three huge tournaments on. And then I guess for London Esports as well, we just had the Call of Duty World Championship, which looked like it cost a lot of money to produce. But I think Gfinity did a great job with that as well.
Yeah.
So just seeing UK become a destination for esports is like, wow, this is super cool. This is becoming real.
Yeah, and to see the esports teams as well. The UK teams growing as well. Like, we've talked about it with Kieran before, of course.
Yes.
LEC, that kind of stuff as well. So that, like, the UK making, not just becoming a venue, but actually making more impact abroad as well, like in Europe and beyond.
Yeah, I think it was really important for, you know, the UK to have a presence in the newly formed, rebranded LEC.
Yeah.
And, you know, Excel did great. You know, I think of their debut season, they were, you know, it's a lot of work to put together a roster.
Yeah.
They did a rebrand. They had to hire people. So they've done a great job as well. So loads of shout outs, and I'm missing some people in there who have done some great work. But all in all, I think if you're in esports right now, you need to be smiling, and it's a positive time.
Oh, definitely. Well, we've talked. I mean, there's lots of highlights, lots of good things that have happened over the last year. Great events, Digital Schoolhouse, and a shout out to them because I'm part of them too. But I mean, we've got to focus a little bit on whether there are challenges that still exist, because you know the state of last year to here, have some of those challenges, some of those issues, problems been fixed, or is it still the Wild West of esports? Is there still a way to go? And what do you think we should be focusing on, sort of moving forward?
So, there are certainly challenges in the industry. I think sort of as a preliminary point, even understanding what esports is for a company like ours, where we are connecting brands and teams and leagues to each other, initially with professional services and agency, and now we'll be moving more towards a tech platform which automates a lot of those processes. Just explaining to a brand or a football team, you know, why is esports important, and their initial response saying, "What the hell is esports?" And you say, "Well, it's competitive video games, and there's a heck of a lot of people that watch other people play video games on platforms like Twitch and YouTube." So that initial hurdle of just understanding the knowledge, but it's improving. You know, more and more people are aware of the term esports. They are aware that esports is not EA Sports. They're aware that esports is not one title.
That's always been a problem, isn't it? I want to get into esports. So, you know, if you set up for sports, it's a warhang, which one? Different audiences, different people, that kind of understanding sort of just pushes down that. That's a challenge.
Definitely. I think that another challenge is for this last year has been, if somebody wants to get into the industry, how do they fit? Where do they fit? I think it's quite beautiful that it's like a blue ocean right now, so you can sort of make jobs for yourself. And I think that, you know, there are academic institutions opening up programs. You know, David Yarnton and I lectured at one in Spain called ISDE, or Instituto. Right. I'm not going to say the name in Spanish. It's going to make me sound pretentious. But Staffordshire, University of Loughborough, doing some esports stuff. So that knowledge base and that path to pro, you know, how do you get into the industry, is becoming more defined. And then I would say, as an industry as a whole, you know, that. I mean, recently we received an email from you know, some investor feedback, and basically saying that, you know, the distribution of prize money and the payment of player salaries are two of the biggest issues in the industry. And whenever you have a nascent industry that doesn't have access to professional resources, you're going to have problems.
Right.
You know, anecdotally, about a year ago, we were part, or at least I was part of, finding some players to play in an esports tournament called eChampions, which, you know, it didn't happen essentially, and I'm still getting texts today from the gamer poacher,
one year later,
yeah, saying, you know, am I ever going to get my prize money that I was promised? And it's like, well, you know, if Edge had been set up beforehand and we had, you know, had our smart contracts platform available, there would not have been the opportunity for people to circumvent their obligation to pay out the prize money that was promised to children, you know, effectively. So you can probably tell I'm still ticked off.
Yeah. Right, the same.
And look, that's our mission, is to end things like that happening, you know?
Yeah, and I would say actually that, even though these issues still exist and these challenges exist, one highlight for me actually in the last year was doing these edgecasts and so on, both when they were audio but also video now, not only because they're fun to do and you get to meet these great people from the industry, but every single person, you can go back and watch the videos, every single person, when I talk about Edge and what we're trying to achieve, and everyone's like, yes, that is what needs to be solved, and we all are excited about that, we all want that.
Yeah, I mean I think, you know, Edge wasn't just born out of, you know, crazy idea that, you know, that the four of us came up with and said, oh, let's just make a platform where, you know, player payments and prize money and sponsorship payments are automated based on the satisfaction of digital KPIs.
Yeah. Doesn't just sound cool. It's actually, there's a problem to be solved.
There's
there.
A real problem.
Yeah.
And until that's solved, you're going to continue to hear stories of, you know, esports organizations forming, promising some kids, you know, we're going to pay you a salary as long as you enter this Fortnite tournament for us. And mm-hmm. then they enter the tournament and then they don't pay out the people that are owed the money. You see contracts that are signed by one party. You know, I got sent a contract about, it must be 2 months ago now, and it said, I'll pay you £500. There wasn't a start date, an end date. It was signed by one person who was the gamer, who was a minor. And it's kind of like,
what's going on?
What's going on? Yeah. So that, but that's, you know, we have acted as an agency and consultancy, and we're really looking forward to having our platform, which
yeah.
has a soft launch on the 4th of June, so that we can try and cut out some of these problems, because it doesn't need to happen. And indeed, everyone in the industry, gamers, teams, leagues, brands, will be more happy, more satisfied, earn more money when they have access to our services. So,
right. Well, that was actually going to be my next question, in a way, is how are you going to celebrate the 1 year birthday? And I guess part of it is that soft launch.
Yeah, so I think anyone that's tuned into the podcast or has met me for a desperate coffee on you know, after having gotten knocked back, the life of an entrepreneur is not a, it's not an easy one.
It's
but
smooth sailing.
But I think we can be, you know, getting to that 1 year
yeah.
mark is we need to pat ourselves on the back, you know.
Yeah.
And then just growing organically, you know, you joining and David Yarnton, who XGfinity Nintendo. And now in the next 4 weeks, we are going to be onboarding some very, you know, people that I respect a lot within the industry, within the games industry, esports industry, and then as well as announcing some investment and announcing.
Yeah, it's a lot happening over the next.
There's
week,
a lot happening.
A lot happening.
This really, you know, I feel like we started the company a year ago,
yeah.
and we are launching the company in June 2019.
Yeah.
Like really making, you know, putting our flag in the ground and saying we are here to stay. And you know, we'd love to work with you, and we'll still be doing a little bit of consultancy, but we need to be focusing on.
I think
the
that's
platform.
Good, you need the consultancy as well. Anyway, to hear the stories, to see what's going on. Because at the end of the day, the tech platform, all that data, it's vital for the industry, especially a massively growing industry. But it is about the people behind that. It is about the, you know, it's a community, the esports community, and yeah, so keep that going, keep that connection going is good.
It's been really fun to be part of. I have to, you know, I have to say, I think you and I have really enjoyed, you know, working together. And now, for anyone that doesn't know, so Mike joined a year ago.
Yeah,
just
at the start.
Just at the start, and we worked with a Yuki run. Yuki is the United Kingdom Interactive Entertainment. They're the trade body for video games here in the UK. We hot desk out of Yuki. And they have a sub company or a group called the Digital Schoolhouse. Mike is now their esports program manager. And so to have that close community relationship
yeah.
with like a customer, we provided them with their platform for teams to be built upon.
Yeah.
And then one of our employees going to one of our co-founders, you know, going to them to help to grow their program. That's quite unusual.
It is.
You might see it in a law firm, you know, sending
yeah.
someone on secondment. Maybe that's why we did it, because we have those legal services. I don't know. But yeah, it's. Hey, I'm buzzing, dude. I'm having a great time.
That's fantastic.
How about you?
Oh, brilliant! Really,
yeah.
really tired, as always, but excited, very, very excited.
Yeah.
With everything that's coming in, both with DSH, as you say, but also with Edge, and I'm looking forward to these announcements where we can finally say who's coming on board. And then we can finally do that soft launch. And we'll
it's been a long time coming.
It's been a long
hey?
Time. Very excited. Very excited. How are you going to celebrate on a personal level? What are you going to do?
So
go to bed.
I'm going to go. No, I'm going. Not that anyone cares, but I'm going to go to Lisbon next week.
Oh, nice.
That's going to be the first vacation I've taken in a couple of years. I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking at the camera over there, and I'm seeing how tired my eyes look. So, yeah, I'm going to do that, but. To be honest, this is just the start. I feel like we are going to be far busier than I think we can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
And how else are we going to celebrate? We'll probably go to the US as well as a
nice.
Company quite quickly. We've, you know, I can't say too much about it right now, but Yeah, it's what else will I do? I might have a kombucha. I'm a big fan of kombucha. Any kombucha brands out there, if you want us to do some influencer marketing with gamers and esports entities, please reach out, send us some free product. I know my friends at Goat have been posting photos of their fridge and asking brands to fill it for us. So we're going to take that idea because the Goat guys are good. They know what they're doing. So,
well, I didn't think we'd end the Edgecast on that note. But but there we go. You never know.
Free kombucha.
Never know what's going to happen. Adam, thank you very much. Everyone, please follow us. Listen to the news because we'll be coming out with some big announcements over the next few weeks ahead of our launch. Yeah. And happy birthday to Edge.
Happy birthday to us. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming on this journey. See you soon.
See ya. Goodbye.